I am so pleased to be in this absolutely gorgeous campus in this incredibly beautiful city, and so honored to have the opportunity to speak with this much human capital assembled in this one room. I've admired many of you for many decades and hope to admire others of you in decades to come, and I'm grateful for all of your time. I mean the words technology in the city in two slightly different senses. One part, one theme of the talk will be about how tectonic shifts in technology shape urbanization, the centripetal forces that pull people into cities and that dominated in the 19th century, or the centrifugal forces that pull people away from cities that came to the fore in the early 20th century. But I also mean technology in the sense that we'll be looking at the ways in which technology measures cities, in which we, as students of space, can increasingly use technology to make sense of the world around us. I, of course, start with an image of an aqueduct for two reasons, one of which is it's hard to think of any technology that was more important in urbanization than the aqueduct. In fact, there's no more important job for city government than providing clean water, no greater challenge than making sure that the sewage goes out and that something drinkable comes in, and aqueducts were a huge part of that. I also put it up there to remind us that, of course, technology wasn't invented by someone in Silicon Valley in 1966, right? Technology is thousands of years old, and of course, it's also there because it's beautiful, and this is Vienna, after all. Now, currently, despite Gandhi's comment, it's hard not to think that we are on a wave of urban strength, right? Gandhi famously viewed the growth of cities as an evil thing, unfortunate for mankind and the world. But while the great man was right on many things, I certainly think that on this one he was completely wrong. As all of us know, in 2007 the UN decreed that we were 50% urban as a species, and it's hard not to think that on net that's a good thing. Because when you compare those countries that are more than 50% urban to those countries that are less than 50% urban, the more urban countries have, on average, incomes that are five times as high. And I think, just as importantly, infant mortality levels that are less than one-third. This shows you the well-known correlation between urbanization and incomes, which, across countries, which, if anything, has only been getting stronger over time. This is perhaps the less well-known correlation between urbanization in 1960 and subsequent income growth among those countries that were relatively poor in 1960. So I'm not claiming that these links are causal. I'm not claiming that, in fact, any country in the world should arbitrarily force people into cities. But it's hard not to look at these and think that urbanization provides an absolute critical pathway out of poverty into prosperity, and that the number of leaders I'm sure all of us have interacted with throughout the world who will tell you they have an urban problem, and their urban problem is they want to know how to keep the poor people home on the farms instead of coming to their cities, right? That viewpoint, that anti-urban viewpoint, is deeply mistaken and problematic. And while they are right to worry about the downsides of density, the demons that come when human beings crowd on limited space, the right answer to that is not to stop the growth of cities, but to figure out how to improve urban governance in a way that makes cities more livable. And I actually will argue that in some sense, it is one of the great vocations of the 21st century to try and figure out how to make the cities of the developing world more livable, more like the great cities of Europe and less like the cities that they currently are. This figure, in some sense, gives you a scope of the sense of the problem. What I've done here is I've taken all the countries in the world in income brackets, $1,000 per capita income brackets, in 1960 and today, and of course I've corrected for inflation. So each one of these shows the share of countries that are more than one-third urban within each one of these income brackets. So if you look at those countries that are between $4,000 and $5,000, both in 1960 and today, about 80% of them are more than one-third urban. And of course, one-third urban is a relatively arbitrary choice, just to give you the sense of having a place which a fair number of people live in dense urban spaces, in cities. If you looked at 3,000 to 4,000, if anything, the share was even higher in 1960 that was more than one-third urban than today. Now, go down to the poorest countries. Go down to those countries with less than $1,000 per capita income. What share of those countries in 1960 was more than one-third urban? It's a really easy number to remember. You can read it right off the graph. It's zero, not a one. Because in 1960, as had been true throughout almost all of human history, to be poor was to be rural. Now, what's our number? Our number is something like 42%. Almost half of these countries are more than one-third urban. Go to $1,000 to $2,000, you've gone from about 20% to 60%. A massive growth of poor world urbanization. I put this graph after the first two because I wanted to make at least a starting point suggesting that this is not a bad thing, that Gandhi is in fact not right. This is not a great terror for the world that great megacities have grown up in sub-Saharan Africa. But we would be blind, we would be foolish, if we were not also aware that limiting space between people, that congestion does not also create downsides, whether it's the traffic congestion that bedevils all of our cities, or the spread of contagious disease, or crime that can occur more easily in a real favela than elsewhere. And dealing with those downsides is, in fact, the great challenge ahead. Now, before we get too, you know, heavily weighted towards these downsides, I think it is worthwhile just emphasizing a point, which is Gandhi right about cities being miserable places? You know, so Gandhi would not have been impressed by higher income levels in cities. This was not did not figure in high in his level of values. He was concerned with spiritual losses or perhaps life satisfaction. So let's just go to the data on life satisfaction. And what I've done here is I've taken all the countries for which we have World Value Survey data from 2005 to 2007. And we're comparing life satisfaction for urban respondents with life satisfaction for rural respondents. So if the country is on the zero, right, it means that it's about the same. People who live in urban areas and people who live in rural areas say that they're about equally happy. So you'll notice Slovenia, the United Kingdom, Egypt, Morocco, they're all pretty much at zero. There are some wealthy countries, New Zealand, Italy, Cyprus, and Spain, where in fact rural dwellers say that they're a lot happier than urban dwellers are. You know, as far as I'm concerned, everyone in New Zealand is kind of happy, so it's maybe not that big of a deal one way or the other. Now, go down to the poorer places, right, the places for which we have data. Every single one of these down here has a substantial gap, and oddly, almost bizarrely, right, Gandhi's own country has, in fact, the largest life satisfaction gap that favors cities of any country in the data. That, in fact, of all countries, it is, in fact, India, which has the largest rural-urban divide that favors cities, not favors rural areas. And it's not that life in a Kolkata slum or in Dharavi in Mumbai, where I'll return to it, it's not that that life isn't tough. It's not that the life that is chronically so beautifully and beyond the beautiful forevers, right, and so painfully, isn't an incredibly tough life, tougher than a life that, you know, almost any of us here have lived. It's just that the right alternative is not our own lives. The right alternative is life in rural India. And the people who come to the slums or the favelas of the developing world are not fools, right? They're not madmen. They're making sensible decisions to find a better future, right? In some sense, when we think about the favelas of Latin America, right, and we are acutely aware of all their downsides, we have to remember that urban poverty isn't typically a sign that cities are failing. It's typically a sign that cities are succeeding. Because cities don't typically make people poor. Cities attract poor people, as indeed these favelas have been attracting poor people for over a century. They attract poor people with the promise of economic opportunity, with the ability to get around without a car for every adult, or with a better social safety net, with better schools, right? And the flow of poor people into cities, whether in Kinshasa or in Rio de Janeiro, is not a sign that the cities are failing. It is a sign of urban promise. It's a sign of urban hope. It is, of course, also a challenge. Because, in fact, all of the flow of poverty into cities creates enormous challenges in terms of governance. In Rio, the problem is not water. In Rio, the problem is crime, which is also abetted and made tougher by density. Now, this growth of the urban world, right, is part of this ebb and flow, this dance of technologies between centrifugal and centripetal pushes. In the 19th century, and we can sort of go back to Weber's great volume on the growth of cities during the 19th century, which was then thought of as being the great urban century, right? It had great waves of technology, mostly about transportation, that pulled people into cities. All of America's older, colder cities were formed on waterways, right? Everyone from the oldest, New York, Boston, typically where the river meets the sea, to the newest, Minneapolis, on the northernmost navigable point on the Mississippi River. They were nodes on a transportation network. They became great not as imperial cities, like Vienna, but as commercial cities, as places of trade. places where, for example, Chicago, right, the linchpin of a great watery arc that went all the way from New York to New Orleans. And of course, Chicago's industry then reflected that transportation. So these are the stockyards, Chicago's paradigmatic industry, which were part of the American problem of moving corn, maize, right, to market, right? Maize was a very low value per ton good. It tended to rot, and so it needed to be transformed into something else to ship it, right? The farmers of Western Pennsylvania transformed it into whiskey, durable, potable, right, worth rebelling over, as they famously did in the 1790s against George Washington when he tried to tax their liquor, right? Cincinnati, America's porkopolis, formed to, again, to transport corn, because, of course, pigs are corn with feet, right? And, you know, salted pork, for some reason or other, has always been easier to sell than salted beef have. As, of course, these stockyards are about, you know, refrigeration. And that's, of course, Armour here, the genius of refrigerated rail cars, who's put the ice on the top so the cold water flowed down and kept the dressed beef refrigerated for the long voyage to the east. Again, right, transportation technology made this city possible. Right? It was because of the large amount of shipments that you had this centralized industry where the cows walked on the hoof to Chicago, they're slaughtered, they're shipped on the rail to the east. Technology is pulling people in. Technology is also enabling the growth of city by internal transportation. Right? The omnibus, the street corn omnibus, pioneered first actually in Paris by Descartes in the 17th century, but really didn't come into its own until the early 19th century, both in London and New York and so forth, right? Again, it's a technology that enabled the city to spread out, enabled, in some sense, the sprawl of the 19th century, like Washington Square in New York. And of course, you know, perhaps the most exceptional of all urban technologies, the skyscraper, right? There's a tall building with a load-bearing steel or cast iron skeleton. Like many great technological innovations, it's a marriage of two ideas. Right? It's the idea of having a tall building with the idea of having an elevator, which was so crucial for this technology to work. So you have the steel frame and so forth. Now, one of the reasons I love the example of the skyscraper is that it reminds us of what cities do that are exceptional in terms of creating these chains of collaborative, you know, innovation that are really responsible for humanity's greatest hits, from Athenian philosophy to Facebook. Right? We can see these often in the arts. So think about the pictorial renaissance in 15th century Florence. Brunelleschi figures out the basic mathematics of linear perspective. He passes it along to his close friend Donatello, who puts it on low relief sculpture on the wall of Orson Michele. Right? Passes it along to Masaccio, puts it in, you know, marvelous painting of St. Peter finding a silver coin in the belly of a fish in the Brancacci Chapel. Passes it along to Fra Filippo Lippi, passes it along to Botticelli and so forth. Each genius, all of whom knew each other personally, riffing on each other's idea. And that's exactly how the skyscraper was created. This building, this one up here, Chicago's home insurance building, is often called the first skyscraper, and its architect, William LeBaron Jenney, is often called the father of the skyscraper. But of course, there's a lively architectural history debate about this, as indeed there's a lively architectural history debate about almost everything that I've been able to figure out, right? Because in fact, this building isn't even a proper skyscraper. Only the front two walls have a load-bearing steel skeleton. The back two walls are traditional load-bearing walls. And so the debate continues. You know, does Jenny deserve this title? What about the guys who were building the Crystal Palace exhibition in London? Or what about St. Augustine's in Paris? Or what about the many Americans who were part of this? Right? What about Louis Sullivan? What about Peter B. White, the great fireproofing engineer? What about Daniel Burnham? What about Root? What about Adler? What about all these guys? The point is, of course, that none of them and all of them deserve the credit for inventing the skyscraper. In fact, the skyscraper, like pretty much anything else our species has ever done, is a collaborative invention where people borrowed ideas from each other. We are great thieves of knowledge, right? We are great thieves of ideas. We are intellectual magpies. It is one of our greatest assets. And indeed, that's exactly what happened in Chicago. They all knew each other, they all stole each other's ideas, and collectively they did something really important. Now, as we move from these centripetal ideas of the 19th century to the centrifugal 20th century, we had a different type of innovation. Now, Ford's Detroit was just another example of these collaborative creativity, right? Detroit's not just about Ford, it's about David Dunbar Buick, it's about Ransom E. Olds, it's about Billy Durant, nearby Flint, it's about the Dodge brothers, it's about the Fisher brothers, it's about a whole cluster of genius, all of whom took this German idea, right, which is something that Americans never like to be remembered, that we, in fact, did not invent the car. Take this German idea, but make it cheap, but make it affordable, which we did, in fact, do, for good and for ill, obviously. And Ford was at the center of this, and he was, as a young man, of course, trained by the city, came to Detroit to learn about cars, and he, you know, his invention, this automated assembly line, was, in a static sense, incredibly good for the city. Made Detroit incredibly productive, created $5 days for ordinary workers, made, in some sense, the American war production of World War II more functional, and, you know, made, by many measures, Detroit the most productive place in the planet by 1950. But think about how antithetical this is to urban form. This type of walled-in factory, separated from the outside world, is sort of, you know, the opposite of what cities are all about. Cities are about connections, cities are about small firms, smart people, and connections to the outside world. How different from this is the plant? And this rise of these factories created this brief moment in which you had urbanized industry on a large scale. And then, of course, as transportation costs declined, this factory doesn't need the city, it doesn't give to the city, it moved to lower cost locales. Right? And this is the real cost of moving a ton of mile by rail in the 20th century, which declined by 90%. And whereas it made sense to put a factory in Detroit near the Great Lakes in 1900, it made no sense by 1960. And so you move first to suburbs, then to low-cost states in the American South, the great work of Tom Holmes comparing counties on pro-union and pro-firm sides of lines, shows the incredible responsiveness of industry growth to having pro-business policies. Right? And of course, industry moved outside of the U.S. altogether. All of this was created by further improvements in transportation costs, which proved in the 20th century to be centrifugal rather than centripetal. And of course, it's not just about the movement of industry to lower cost locales, it's about the movement of population outside of the city core. It's about the car, and it's about rebuilding space around the car. And of course, this is not just an American thing. America is not just the only country with sprawl in this world, right? This is Paris, and that's France, and that's Canada, right? Of course, we are particularly good at it in America. And of course, we built the infrastructure that goes along with it. The work of Nate Baum Snow reminds us that each new highway that cut into an urban core after World War II reduced the central city's population by about 18% relative to the metropolitan area as a whole. Right? Public policies that subsidize infrastructure are essentially pushing people away, subsidize this type of infrastructure, of course, pushing people away from city centers. They're providing once more centrifugal technologies. Another way of thinking about this, of this declining transportation cost, of in some sense a flattening of the world, is that it enabled urban spaces to move, particularly within the US, particularly in areas in which there were huge differences and not strong ties to region as in Europe. It enabled spaces to move to areas, people to move to areas where it had a consumption advantage rather than a production advantage. Right? That whereas in 1900 you needed to be close to the coal mine, you needed to be close to the waterways, by 2000, you could pretty much move wherever you wanted to live. You move to Las Vegas, you could move to Phoenix, you could move to any place that had consumer amenities that were attractive. In Europe, we're used to thinking of these consumer amenities as intimately tied to things like the opera in Vienna, or other things that are about, you know, man-made cultural amenities. In America, we have less of those, of course. What we have is weather, right? And there's no variable that better predicts metropolitan area growth during the 20th century than January temperature, which is, of course, this huge rebalancing from producer cities to consumer cities. You see this also in the happiness data. So these are happiness gaps across the US, which, again, I see as sort of a reflection of what's going on in terms of consumer amenities. And this shows the relationship between urban growth and self-reported happiness. So as you can see, particularly the declining areas of the US really are much less happy. Among fast-growing areas, there's not much difference. But at this scale, there's a strong positive effect. What's interesting is it turns out that the declining areas were unhappy first. It's not that Detroit is unhappy because it's declining. It looks like Detroit is declining because it was unhappy. When we go back and we look at happiness data from the 70s or even census data from the 1940s, the unhappiness of the older, colder cities in the US, particularly these sort of inland industrial cities, seem to occur first. Turns out the same pattern between happiness and urban growth, with the kink around zero, holds for the UK as well as the US. It's actually the same basic pattern. Hit with the move to sun and sprawl, America's older, colder cities were in great trouble in the 1970s, fiscal distress, much more so than in Europe. But of course, I remember London well from the 1980s, and London didn't look like it was headed for, you know, any great future either. These were the 10 largest cities in the US, not metropolitan areas, these are cities. So this is their decline is reflecting both suburbanization and the move away from these areas. But 8 of the 10 had lost at least 20% of their population by now. Only New York and Los Angeles, which is sui generis, stands differently. The amazing thing in some sense is that this narrative of ever-declining transportation costs leading to ever-wider dispersal of population, a narrative that was kept up in the 80s and the 1990s by the cyberseers and technoprophets who predicted that information technology would make face-to-face contact completely obsolete, and we would all just live in electronic villages and dial it in from whatever, you know, using whatever technology of the moment worked. That didn't happen. That while everything seemed so strongly centrifugal in the 1980s, cities have had a remarkably good 30 years. And this is true, of course, both in Europe and the US. It's true both for Seattle and for Milan. And of course, you can see this in the data. This is US, this is EU. The blue line here is the relationship between income and density, right? And the densest tenth of America's counties have incomes that are on average 50% higher than the least dense half, and in population growth. You know, and that's the same thing that's true for the EU. If anything, the density relationship with the EU is even stronger. And of course, I'm just showing this in a broad brush, but as we all know, there's a vast literature documenting the strength of agglomeration economies and that they have not in any sense gone down over the past 30 years in the US or the EU. When we try and understand what's going on, why cities have come back, why those cyberseers were incorrect, I think at least one plausible hypothesis is that what declining transportation costs have done, what a more complex world has created, is that it's created a world in which face-to-face contact is actually more, not less valuable, because the returns to human capital are higher. We are a social species. We get smart by being around other smart people. This is why universities remain important. This is why cities remain important. Cities allow the transmission of information on a daily basis in a way that's just much less true in low-density areas. This is why, if you think about of all the industries in the world that should be able to do away with face-to-face contact, right? It should be Silicon Valley, right? They should be Google. What company in the world should be able to send people home and say, you don't need to show up anymore? More than Google. And yet, does Google do that? No. They buy this vast Googleplex. They buy 1.5 million square feet in downtown New York, and they try to get everyone there all the time. Because this is how creativity works. Is that we're with each other, we learn from each other, we connect with one another, we don't go away. Every one of us in our daily lives has experienced the magic of learning from someone near to us. This is what cities do, and in a world in which that learning is more valuable, face-to-face contact is more, not less valuable. And the more complicated the idea is, the easier it is to get lost in translation. And anyone who's ever taught, and I know almost everyone here has, right? The hard part about teaching is not knowing your subject material, it's knowing whether or not anything you're saying is getting through. Right? It's knowing whether or not your students are getting any of it. Right? And face-to-face contact just makes that a lot easier. That's why, you know, Mayor Bloomberg has the Wallace office at Bloomberg LLP. Now, these urbanization relationships that are well known, these agglomeration economies, I'm doing a slight twist here. We know a bunch of facts for the developing world, for the developed world, but as we think about the developing world, we suddenly know much less. And one of the things I've recently been working on is trying to put together to what extent are the facts that we know for the developed world also true for the developing world. So one of the facts, one of the biggest facts we have is the existence of these agglomeration economies. And one of the things that I've done is to try and see, are these coefficients roughly the same for the US, Brazil, India, and China? And they're actually very, very close. Coefficients about 0.05, 0.06 seem to be true for all three of these countries. So there is some evidence that at least some of the knowledge, as the world urbanizes, some of the knowledge we've gained from the West will also be usable. But there are other areas in which we just don't know. And now I'm doing a slight interlude to technology to measure cities. Because part of the issue with the developing world is we actually don't know what the incomes are. And we don't know how patterns of income, patterns of wealth and poverty look. But we do increasingly have pictures. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how pictures, we can use pictures to measure the spatial patterns of wealth and poverty in the developing world. But to do that, I need to give you a little bit of a background on this, which is the fundamental tool that I'm going to be talking about is Google Street View, right? So Google has sent out these cars with these cameras throughout the world, 3,000 cities, 100 countries across the world, high-resolution imagery at the street level. They've also tried to keep the weather constant. They've tried to make sure that it's a bright, clear day at all points in time. So gradually, we've been moving towards a world in which Google street-level images can actually replace nightlights, which has been the backstop technology for trying to measure wealth and poverty in places where you have no government statistics that are worth anything on the street. So the key is to combine Google Street View and computer vision. So computer vision came out of a desire of being able to identify particular things. You know, is this a frog or not? Is this a bird or not? Is there a person, dog, chair, to identify these things? We're trying to identify something that's both easier and poorer. Does easier and harder. Does the image of a street tell you, are rich or poor people living there? Does the image of the street tell you, are there potholes? Is it aesthetically beautiful, right? All of these things are things that potentially the pictures can get us. So our work with Street View takes two forms, one of which is looking at subjective measures of quality and can you predict them with the images, and secondly, predicting socioeconomic indicators from urban imagery, objective measures. So the big payoff from the latter is using Street View when you don't have other measures of income. So let's start with the first bit, and this is really, Cesar Hidalgo had this idea, and I've done a little bit of work with him on later work. The starting point of this was just crowdsourcing imagery. So he wanted to know what streets looked safe and which streets didn't look safe. And what they did is they gave hundreds of thousands of people, now more than a million, pairs of images, and you were supposed to rate the images, which one you found safer or not. So based on that, so based on the ratings, you could figure out this thing looked on average not very safe to people. You didn't feel safe walking down this one. This one looks pretty safe relative to people. And you can, you know, by crowdsourcing it, you can get images of anything you want. Does it look attractive, not attractive? Does it look pedestrian friendly? Does it not look pedestrian friendly? Okay, now, the big leap here was to not see that as an end in itself, but instead see that as training data. Because if you were stuck using that, if you're stuck using the ratings, you were limited by the number of images that you could get rated by ordinary people. And the leap was done by a co-author of mine, Nikhil Naik, who was a student of Cesar's at the time, who said, I know what to do. I'm going to use computer vision algorithms to just regress, essentially, regress this perceived safety on the pixels. So essentially think about this as a regression where you feed in data where you've got an image. The image is marked by a matrix of the things in the pixels. It's organized through standard computer vision techniques. And the perceived safety is regressed on this. Rest on the images, and with that, you get a predicted street score. Now, from this, you can predict everywhere, at least everywhere the images overlap. You no longer need to restrict yourself to ones in which human beings have ratings. You can use everywhere. And with that, we can also go back in time. So this is what we've done, is we've taken the 2007 and 2014 using this common model and looked at changes. So this is a neighborhood that actually these images, one which looked dangerous, one which looked safe, this is the same place. Right? But it shows a massive increase in safety over the time, at least in perceived safety. There also are some places, this is Detroit, unsurprisingly, where you've seen a decline in perceived safety. This is places where you've seen the largest increases in perceived safety in New York City. So you see areas of Brooklyn and some of the West Side has seen the most gaps. And we've done a little bit of paper. We've tried to look at what factors predict growth and safety. And there's just the level of safety. It turns out both in the levels and in the growth, the same factors predict both of them, that population density and education are, unsurprisingly, the largest predictors of perceived safety. Those census tracts, those areas where educated people live, are the ones that people perceive are safe. And in fact, in terms of these ratings, density is perceived as being a huge contributor to safety, sort of very much of a Jane Jacobs effect. The same things are true for changes. If I look at changes in other variables, the other thing that really comes through is adjacency matters. So if you're surrounded by educated areas, you have an increase in your perceived safety. If you're close to the city center, you have an increase in your perceived safety. So this is just for five cities, but we see the streetscape changing, and we're measuring it in ways that we couldn't have measured before we had these technologies. The other thing we've done is we've tried to use this to predict income. Now, at this point in time, this is just a proof of concept, because no one cares about being able to predict income from images in New York City. We got what the incomes are. We don't need to predict it from the images. What we want to be able to do is to do this for Bangladesh. But if you do it in New York, we can do exactly the same thing. We regress the income on the pixels, and you get a heck of a fit. In all cases, because the risk for overfitting is enormous, you always have to split things between a testing sample and a training sample. So this is the testing sample, which is an 85% R-squared. If you do this on the training sample, you get an 81% R-squared. So you can explain over 4/5 of the variation in income with the pixels, right? Which is vastly better, for example, than if you tried to predict it just with demographic characteristics of the census tract. Somewhat amazingly, the New York trained model also does an incredibly good job for Boston. An R-squared taking the New York model to Boston of 86%. So there's promise in this, but I will say we've been messing around with Indonesian data. where, remember, we need both images and then some match survey data, so you need to train off some data, and the Indonesian data has not been coming nearly as well. So I would say it is very much not proven that we can use the same technology to measure wealth and poverty in the developing world. The issues may just be different. We're now moving to Chile, which seems like it's less daunting than the slums of Jakarta. Right, this is just making the case of this. Okay, back to the arc. And of course, the fact that, you know, skills are such a good predictor of urban success goes along with this view that it's about cities as being centers of knowledge, centers about idea creation. This is, of course, the skills relationship with population growth within the U.S. across counties. If you look across the U.S., Brazil, India, and China, interestingly, the skills relationship with growth is actually much larger in Brazil than it is in the U.S., both for population growth and for income growth. So if anything, skills appear to be even more powerful there. In China, the effect on population growth is huge. The income effect is negligible. And in India, it's fairly small. So India has much less of a population growth effect, and we don't actually have income growth. So I would say the skills growth facts are less reliable. But where they do show up, they're much larger than in the U.S. One of the things that's fun with Chinese data is that we have a very long history here. So they have Chinese administrative data going back to the Ming Dynasty. And if you just use the share of the population that passes the test to become Ming bureaucrats in the Ming Dynasty, that actually does a very good job of both predicting skills today and predicting which regions have done well across areas. The other fact, of course, that's associated with skills is the relationship with earnings. And again, this is done in the form of human capital externalities. Jim Rausch and Enrico Moretti were the pioneers of this. So you can do this for Brazil, US, India, and China as well. And you see large effects everywhere. If anything, the coefficients are much larger in the developing world than in the US. So if anything, skills appear to be even more important for urban success in the developing world than they do in the US. And this is, of course, just skills and per capita GDP, which is incredibly strong. I'm going to skip over the entrepreneurship results because, in fact, entrepreneurship is a fact. Measures of entrepreneurship correlate very well with urban growth in the U.S. We actually don't have those measures for the developing world, and it's time that we do. I'm going to skip over that and skip to the tip to the Dharavi slum. Now, entrepreneurship, at least I think of it, as yet another form of human capital, and it's a form of human capital that's particularly important for urban resilience because it's where new firms come from, it's where new urban directions come from. Now, at least for me, I go to a developing world slum like Dharavi, and I think it's the most entrepreneurial place I've ever been to. You just walk through it, and it's just crammed with human ingenuity. It's just crammed with talent of people doing new things. Now, will these small businesses ever grow beyond five people? I don't know. That's the perpetual problem of entrepreneurship. But it's hard not to, in the developing world, but it's hard not to be awed with just the sheer human energy. And yet, while you're being awed with Indian energy, you walk out, and you see a kid defecating in an unpaved road. You know, the water is unsafe to drink, and the electricity is intermittent, and it reminds you of those demons that come with density. It reminds you of the enormous challenges of making these living spaces humane. And that's, in some sense, the great challenge ahead. It's not that we're going to tell Indian entrepreneurs how to be better entrepreneurs, but we maybe can try and help them deal with these downsides of density. It's worthwhile remembering that the cities of the West did not become safe by accident. A boy born in Elizabethan London or in 1900 New York had a life expectancy gap relative to the rest of the country of about 6 or 7 years. It could expect you to live 6 or 7 years less. Today, life expectancy is about 3 years longer in New York City than elsewhere. Right? That change did not happen easily. Typically, the story goes that this was about investment in water. And that is certainly true. That is one part of it. America's cities and towns were spending as much on clean water at the start of the 20th century as the federal government was spending on everything except for the post office and the army. But infrastructure is not enough. It's only part of the story. And the way that you see this is that the engineering triumphalism story is incorrect, is New York's great story for infrastructure is the building of the Croton Aqueduct in 1842. And the story goes that, you know, New York was filthy, and then this aqueduct was built. Here's an image of it, and it brought in the clean waters from upstate, and all of a sudden New York was healthy. Well, look at the time series, okay? Croton Aqueduct is opened in 1842. They're having cholera epidemics for 25 years after that aqueduct. My great-great-great-great-great-grandfather died in this one, 1849, 7 years after the Croton Aqueduct was opened. It would have come to a surprise to him that this engineering feat had solved everything. The reason why it didn't is that engineering isn't enough. We also need economics. We also need incentives. And the problem is that you build an aqueduct, you build a water main, and you charge people too much to use it, and they won't adopt it. And that's what happened in New York. You had what's called a last mile problem. And the last mile problem is a huge problem in the cities of the developing world as well, that the UN or some other donor will provide funding for a water main, and poor people don't want to connect. It's very similar to the same point that is made about traffic congestion, right? There's no way to just build your way out of traffic congestion because of the fundamental law of highway traffic as identified by Gilles Durenton and Matthew Turner, that vehicle miles traveled increase roughly one for one with highway miles built, right? If you double the number of highways, you double the number of highway drivers, right? And the only way to deal with this is to actually impose costs on driving. Singapore, of course, has had congestion pricing for 40 years, and the stuff works. Now, many times when we think about this, these issues in the developing world, we often have two different technologies, always competing. Technology that was often built for us, built for the wealthy world, coinciding with a technology that was built for poor people that came about. So to give you an example, think about jitneys or jeepneys in Manila, right? Cheap minibuses that carry people around, right? Coexisting with the Gao train, a sleek, fast train like something you would see in Dijon. These two technologies exist at the same time period. A fancy modern sewerage system combined with a pit latrine. All of these are examples of having multiple technologies. And the issue often in the developing world is, when do you want to push everyone from the poor technology to the rich technology? When do you want to upgrade the poor technology? Okay, and both things are going on simultaneously. I think probably in the case of jitneys, the right answer is not to try and put Johannesburg all in fast, sleek trains that would be appropriate for Denmark, but to try and upgrade gradually the quality of minibus services. Right? In the answer of sewers or water, probably the right answer is to move people entirely. And this is, you know, this is an example of some of my work from water in Lusaka, where we've been worried about this stuff. And you have this problem of adoption. This is from a paper with Giacomo Ponzetto and Nava Ashraf, and this is the only economic theory that I'm going to give you, but it's sort of, I think, important for thinking about this, that if you're trying to engineer adoption, you've built this thing, you built this water main, the people aren't connecting to it. You've got two options. Either you subsidize or you penalize non-adoption. At least I don't know of any other things that really work. Now, we can think about clever behavioral things, which, of course, everyone's all about sort of figuring out how to nudge. But the basics of this are you either have to bribe people to do it, you have to subsidize, or you need to penalize them. New York City actually starts with providing clean water in free hydrants, but they don't build enough hydrants. The hydrants are expensive, so people don't use them, and they still use the shallow wells next to their home. They aren't willing to walk to carry the water because water is heavy to carry. New York only gets it to work by actually penalizing landlords who don't use the sewers, who don't connect to water. Now, what this graph is supposed to tell you is along this axis is supposed to be the quality of the executive branch, so how well you can do subsidies without waste. And along this one is the quality of the judiciary branch, how well you can use penalties without corruption and extortion. And along this axis, it's how wasteful the executive branch is, how wasteful subsidies are. So if the executive branch is sufficiently competent, so this is down here, you just use subsidies. If the judicial branch is sufficiently competent, which is up here, you can do fines. But if you're in this intermediate range, and if you're down here and everything's awful, you have no adoption. But if you're in this intermediate range, the right answer is a combination of the two. And this is the sort of point that I want to get across. You want fines that are very mild, that are not subject to abuse, and particularly are not going to lead to extortion of the innocent. Right? Because if you're extorting both innocent and guilty, then you've lost any incentives to adopt. So you need mild fines, which is completely opposite of what Gary Becker was emphasizing in his 68 Crime and Punishment, of sort of having heavy fines that you push things up. So you don't have to have a high probability of detection. You need the fines that are small enough so they're not going to be abused. And then you have to make up for the rest with subsidies. And in the case of, let's say, open street defecation, I'm very fond of pushing the idea of punishing kids who defecate in the street with making them spend an hour doing math problems in a community center. Something of that nature that's by and large benign, but not, you know, but still likely, if they're anything like my kids, to be seen as being a heavy punishment indeed. Bus rapid transit has obviously been a huge plus. I'm going to skip the stuff on homicides and just make two last points before I finish up. One of which is, we haven't talked very much about the physical side of the city. And of course, we're surrounded by this amazing architecture, so it's easy to sort of think about this. When you think about cities, particularly in the developing world, there are two rival errors. One of is NIMBYism, not in my backyardism, and I think I've made this point over and over again, but artificially restricting the growth of cities means that they become too expensive, they risk becoming boutique towns only for the wealthy. If it's Mumbai, it's not that it becomes a boutique town, it becomes a dysfunctional town. So instead of building up high-density areas, you have thousands of square miles or hundreds of square miles of illegal settlements because you haven't allowed the building up to enable the city to transform itself. But there is another demon, which is particularly common in the developing world, which is monumentalism, which is forgetting that the real city is always the people living in the city and thinking that it is instead the structures. So think about, you know, despots throughout history that have built great towers to monumentalize themselves, and this goes on. This can be done through private folly as well as public folly in lots of different ways. I'm going to skip over this, but certainly when we think about the world of China right now, we're in the midst of what may be the world's greatest housing boom, maybe the greatest focus on sort of physical structures, and certainly the public sector has played a role in making that happen. And these are people lying out, desperate to get units in a residential project. This just gives you a sense. I'm comparing the U.S. versus the Chinese housing price growth. First, second, and third tier cities for China are up here. These are the U.S. ones. U.S. is 96 to 2006. China is 2003 to 2013. The point of this is the price growth is vastly higher than in the U.S., right? The U.S. housing boom was nothing than what, like what China has been experiencing in terms of price growth. Secondly, this is Chinese construction, again, during the past 10 years versus U.S. construction between 96 and 2006. This building boom is just extraordinary in terms of its quantities. Now, in one sense, right, this is a country of 1.3 billion people. They need to build to urbanize. On the other hand, the structures often seem very mismatched with current needs, built on a level of luxury and high-end space that is not at all where many of the current residents are. And one of the ways of getting at the mismatch is just the huge rise in vacant inventories. And we've tried to measure this in two different ways. There are two ways in which you get vacancies in China. One of which is you have developers who hold units rather than selling them, because they typically get more forbearance from their lenders, who are typically public, than American developers would. So they're able to leave them empty rather than causing a run on the market by selling them quickly. The other thing is that investors buy units and leave them empty, which is something that's just very different from the U.S. and much of the European model, that you will own a unit for 20 years now and leave it empty. Now, I'm not predicting a Chinese housing bust. I don't know what will happen. And I believe, actually, that if the Chinese government were to radically shut down new construction, prices could easily stay high. This is a country that will be urbanizing, and this is a country that's moving forward. Our estimates that come from a paper we've been writing lately suggest that if you do have continuing large supply in lines with recent things, it's hard not to think that there will be some form of adjustment. But again, it's hard to know. But certainly, if you think about sort of building, there's both the underbuilding, which is the Indian case, and there's the potentially significant overbuilding that occurs in other parts of the world. Last point, and again, we heard a lot about greenness, and I think it would be a mistake for me not to end by emphasizing that even though cities look brown, they are actually often green. And in fact, the right answer is not that low-density dwelling is somehow or other the right answer for carbon reductions. And I'd like to make this point with an anecdote about a young Harvard College graduate who, on a beautiful spring day, went for a walk in the woods outside of Concord, Massachusetts, and he did a little fishing, and the fishing was good, because there hadn't been much rain lately. But when he came to cook the fish into a chowder, a soup, the wind flicked the flames to the nearby dry grass, and a fire started, and it spread, and it spread. And by the time it was done, it was a raging inferno that had burned up more than 400 acres of prime woodland. The young man was castigated in his own time as an enemy of the environment. The Concord Freeman, the local paper, called him a flibbertigibbet, which I think was pretty bad for 1844. And it's hard not to think that they were right, right? I can't think of any young man living in the same time period who did as much damage to the environment as this guy did, burning up hundreds of acres of woods. Yet, of course, today he is revered in America as the secular saint of American environmentalism. His name is Henry David Thoreau, and his book, Walden, preaches a gospel of what a wonderful thing it is to live surrounded by nature. Now, it may have been wonderful for Thoreau to live surrounded by nature, but I can't see that he did nature very much good by living surrounded by it. And in fact, I think an equally good lesson to draw from Thoreau's life is that we are a dangerous species, and if you love nature, you should stay away from it, as indeed Thoreau would have done a great deal of good for nature if he'd stayed home in Cambridge rather than living in the woods. Now, of course, I'm an economist, so I actually don't believe, I'm not a lifestyle consultant, I think that people should be absolutely free to choose wherever they live. And in fact, you know, full disclosure, when I started acquiring small children about 10 years ago, I moved from about here, where I lived a fairly modest environmental life, to about here and started doing almost as much damage to the environment as Thoreau did, what with the driving and the home heating and all this other stuff. But there is a statistical point to this, which is when we actually compare different parts of the U.S. holding income and family size constant, and that's actually important, we find that the places that look green are brown, and the places that look brown are green. And that's because of much longer distances being driven in green spaces, and because of typically much smaller built housing units in dense areas. And one of the things I think that's really important that the spatial perspective needs to give to thinking about green buildings is it's not just enough to think about the LEED certification of the building in and of itself. It's not just enough to think about the building's own certification. We can build an environmentally sensitive unit, right, in and of itself if it's got one story that's packed full of solar cells in the middle of nowhere. But that person will, as a functional matter, will drive everywhere they go, right? So in fact, even if the house in and of itself is environmentally green, the lifestyle isn't. And that's sort of a really important thing, is to think of this as a system. That in fact, you'd rather give up a bit of carbon emissions in terms of the structure to put up with the elevator if you get to take on less of the car. And that's the, you know, as the great growing economies of India and China see themselves urbanized, this becomes the critical issue, right? If their per capita carbon emissions rise to that seen in the sprawling United States, global carbon emissions go up by 130%. If they stop at the level seen at wealthy but hyper-dense Hong Kong, global carbon emissions go up by less than 30%, right? We have a lot to gain if these cities build up rather than, if these countries build up rather than out. I will just end on three final questions, which I think are really important. And I haven't said enough about one of them. But the first is, will future technological change continue to be centripetal? Will we have another centrifugal wave? And I think we don't know the answer to that. I'm certainly betting on continued urbanization, continued density, particularly in the developing world. But we've seen history dance back and forth between the two alternatives. Secondly, will technology solve public problems? Or will public control constrain technology? And I think about the regulation of Uber, for example. And I think one of the things that's really important is the extent to which technology in solving public problems also tends to go together with human capital, right? When you have workers that are well-educated, they're well-skilled, they're able to use the technology. When they're not, they aren't. And that creates this sense that both in the quality of government as well as incomes, technology can be a further creator of inequality. And that's the last question I think that we have. Can technology make opportunity more widespread? For while this has been an amazing 30 years for cities and an amazing 30 years for the development of the world in lots of ways, and as we know, global inequality has actually gone down, within country inequalities have gone up. And the big challenge ahead is whether or not technologies and the cities that create those technologies, in which those technologies can flourish, will also be places that are engines of opportunity as well as engines of innovation. And that's, in some sense, the final question that I want to leave you with. And thank you very much for your time. Sure.